Well, good morning and welcome everybody. That's loud enough, I think. Welcome to Boxwood Baptist Church this morning. Good to see everyone here bright and early at 20 past nine. Apologies to people watching online. The clock seems to have stopped sometimes this morning. I thought I had like another 45 minutes to prepare. Welcome. It's great to see some faces back after holidays and some new faces that we haven't seen before. So good to see everyone here and joining us this morning. You'll have seen, if you've had a bit of time to sit and prepare for the service, there's a version of Psalm 23 written on the front of the record, which is a wonderful start to the morning if you weren't feeling tense enough already. So let's try and undo that with a different version of Psalm 23 as we begin our service this morning. The Lord is my pace setter. I shall not rush. He makes me stop and rest for quiet intervals. He provides me with images of stillness, which restore my serenity. He leads me in ways of meaningfulness through calmness of mind, and his guidance is peace. Even though I have a great many things to accomplish each day, I will not fret, for his presence is here. His timelessness, his all-importance, will keep me in balance. He prepares refreshment and renewal in the midst of my activity, by anointing my mind with oils of tranquility. My cup of joyous energy overflows. Surely harmony and effectiveness shall be the fruit for my hours. For I shall walk in the pace of my Lord and dwell in his house forever. With that hopefully calming everyone down a little bit more, let's join in our first hymn, very suitably called Come and Find the Quiet Center. Again, a warm welcome to everyone, and for those who did the usual sneak in during the first hymn, there's always a few. Welcome, and we invite everyone to join us for morning tea in the barn afterwards, just behind, and a chance to catch up on where people have been and what they've been doing over the last few weeks. I know Teresa's been trotting all around the countryside, so I'm keen to hear a bit more about that. And in that spirit, it's time to share our news with our community. So is there anyone, any information or news that Minwen?
do a little advertisement again. Lest we forget. So how do we make sure we don't forget? Maybe everyone join us at the Cenotaph. Give us a little talk about what is Anzac Day. 2 o'clock until 3:30 at the English Corner at the Box Hill Garden, please. Thank you.
It's been pointed out that the clock has stopped, but one thing that never stops is calendars. And this week, on the 28th, there is an event of primordial significance in our community in that one of our members has a significant birthday, and that is Glenys. 21 again. And I thought it would be nice if we just acknowledge that and sing happy birthday to Glenys, if that's all right. It's a very significant birthday.
To come here so everyone at home can hear you as well.
Everybody in the world.
Yes.
Wow. Well, firstly, I've got to say it's hard to be glad this morning because there's a demon supporter here who's smiling at me. Well, just that the groceries for Box Hill Community Support Centre, we've started again. There was a very good bag of groceries there for more than a week. Sorry, folks, whoever put it there. But I finally delivered it last Wednesday. So we start, and we always do it on the first Sunday in the month, Communion Sunday. So if you can bring one or two grocery items, the basket is just inside the door here. Put them there, and I will deliver them on the next couple of days. It's a great commitment. Doesn't cost us too much. And it does help those folks who need some help. Thank you.
On that theme of sharing food with the community, you would have seen last week we started initiative within a space of like 48 hours, an initiative started, which was around providing free bread and bakery products to the community. This is refuse, essentially, from a local baker's, which is still incredibly fresh and still wonderful. We've been living on it all week. But it gets thrown out, and it's an absolute crime. So last week, a group called Orchard Providor, which is a local social enterprise in Box Hill, teamed up with us, and we did our best to distribute basically an entire station wagon full of bread to the community. We got about halfway through it, so that's why we've been living on bread for the last week. But we had our second run yesterday, and we're pleased to say same amount of food and not a scrap was left. You know, we cleaned it out, increasingly numbers of people coming in, which was wonderful for those who need it, but also wonderful just in the sense of a community engagement. You know, we were serving some coffee, and it was just a nice experience to see volunteers from the community, people from the community who have never stepped inside our doors before. Where this is going to go is kind of exciting and terrifying. We've already had inquiries from another bakery, including all Laurent bakeries in the region, so 11, and they want to give every bakery every day, which is a little bit terrifying. I don't know if we're up for that, but it shows the volume that's out there and what we could be doing with it. So it's very exciting, a little bit terrifying, but keep it in your prayers and come along if you're up at 7:30 in the morning. I know that's early, but that's there basically so you can get the bread while it's still fresh. And trust me, you need to get there at 7:30 because there's a queue already forming outside the barn at that time. So it's very exciting. Thanks to all those who contributed and came along and took their share as well yesterday. We're going to do something that we haven't done probably for 18 months almost, and that's take up the offering. We can actually feel safe to do it again. So if our stewards can remember what they're supposed to do and come and collect our offerings, we understand a lot more people will be giving electronically, and feel free to just let the bag pass you by if that's the case.
Thank you.
Please join me as we pray. Lord, as we bring our gifts to you this morning to contribute to the work of your people and your spirit in Box Hill and beyond, we also recognise on this day those who have given their all in conflicts and wars across the globe. Whatever their motivation and situation, we recognise their sacrifice, their giving, and the hurt and sorrow inflicted on those around them then and to this day. We cannot undo what has been done, but we pray that what we bring to you today and the offerings we give will continue the work of the peacemakers in all places of the world. May such sacrifices never be needed again. Amen. Well, as the offering prayer mentioned, and as Min Wen pointed out to us, today is Anzac Day, a day which is probably approached differently for each and every one of us, depending on our experience, our family, and our attitudes. For some, this is a day to remember and recognise the courage of our armed services, past and present. For some, a day to mourn and pray. And for some, perhaps a mix of both. And especially in the church, I think this can be a difficult tension to resolve in our own hearts and minds. Yet the day is important in our national psyche and indeed our own as a community. On your way in this morning, you'll have walked past a list of names of those from this community that served and died during the wars. Many of them will be familiar names to us. If you, like me, no longer see that anymore, you just walk past it as part of the furniture, I encourage you to stop and spend a moment as you walk out today in quiet reflection for those who once sat in the very same pews that you are and gave their lives in conflict. So this morning, we seek to remember them and all those who have served and sacrificed, those we know personally and beyond. So let us keep those people in our minds as we sing our first hymn in this part of our service. God is our strength and refuge. And we'll follow this with some prayers of remembrance and some quiet reflections. So please stand as we sing together. Let us pray, and then we'll join in a minute's silence together. We remember with thanksgiving and sorrow those whose lives in world wars and conflicts, past and present, have been taken away. For the people who love them in death as in life, for all members of all armed forces who are in danger this day, remembering family, friends, and all who pray for their safe return. We pray for the wounded and the disturbed, the grieving and the homeless, and for all who suffer due to war and conflict. For women and children and men whose lives are disfigured by war and violence. For peacemakers and peacekeepers who seek to keep this world secure and safe. For those known to us who need Jesus now. God of truth and justice, hear our prayers for all who strive for peace and all who yearn for justice. Help us today remember the cost of war to work for a better tomorrow. And as we honour the past and we put our faith in your future. In our remembrance, we know silence is not enough to change the world. I have come that you may have life and life to the full. In our remembrance, we know silence is not enough to bring peace to the world. Behold, I make all things new. In our remembrance, we know silence is not enough to change the minds of leaders. Your light must shine before people. In our remembrance, we know silence is not enough to change the way we do things. This is what I command, love one another. In our remembrance, we know silence is not enough to convey the truth of war. Every tree is known by the fruit it bears. The mouth speaks what the heart is full of. In our remembrance, we know silence is not enough, but your words are, come and follow me. We're going to close with another hymn, but before we do that, I'm going to say, Tian, can you open the door for Scotty? Because he's sitting out there with doors closed. We're going to sing with a closing hymn. It's a hymn which this tune will be familiar to you. What hymn is it from, Jim? Dear Lord and Father of Mankind, Repton. So the tune will be familiar to some of you, but the words have been changed. And it's a hymn that was written especially for, I think it's from the UK, and it was written for Memorial Day. And I've adopted it for us to sing together today. So please stand with me as we sing this song, remembering what this day is about.
Come soon the day when peace shall reign and nations fight no more, when spears are turned to pruning hooks and love displays hateful love.
Michelle, to bring our readings to us this morning.
The first reading from Mark chapter 2, 15 to 28. And as he sat at dinner in Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were also sitting with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the scribes of the Pharisees saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, they said to his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" When Jesus heard this, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need for a physician, but those who are sick. I have come to call not the righteous, but the sinners." Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and people came and said to him, "Why do John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast?" Jesus said to them, "The wedding guests cannot fast while the bridegroom is with them, can they? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast on that day. No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old cloth, otherwise the patch pulls away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins, otherwise the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is lost, and so are the skins. But one puts new wine into fresh wineskins." One Sabbath, he was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck the heads of grain. the Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need of food? He entered the house of God when Abiathar was high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priests to eat, but he gave some to his companions. Then he said to them, 'The Sabbath was made for humankind and not humankind for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even on the Sabbath.'" The second reading from Acts chapter 4, 32 to 35. "Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need." This is the word of the Lord.
We got any fans here of Old People's Home for 4-year-olds? Yes. Quite exciting. I find it lovely. And I want to introduce you today to the concept of Old People's Church for 4-year-olds. I want to tell you a story about one of my inspirational colleagues in ministry, Mrs. C. That's not her initial of either of her names. To protect her identity, I'm using this. And I printed it out to stop me from actually using her real name or real initial. Mrs. C was a legend. She was a Sunday school teacher to die for. She was such a good Sunday school teacher, she even drove some people out of our church. She did that by, we were in a very, very hot building, and she had a group of little 6 and 7-year-olds. It had been 40 degrees for about 5 days and the place was roasting. And so she took the children out and bought them all an ice cream in an air-conditioned ice cream parlour at her own expense. And one family who were new to our church decided that was enough. That was the straw that broke the camel's back. "We're here to learn about Jesus, not have a good time and go out eating ice cream," was the family's view. But another thing that Mrs. C did was once invited me as the minister of this church if I would come along to Sunday school and read the story of Jonah and the whale. Now, if I handed the microphone over here, who thinks they could do a pretty good job of reading the story of Jonah and the whale? Most people? Pretty straightforward? Some of the learned professors of theology amongst us, should there be any, might say that that could not possibly have happened. Human beings can't live inside a whale. And I might have agreed to that before I went to see Mrs. C's Sunday school class. The invitation came 7 weeks prior to the event. And every week she reminded me, "You're still right for that Sunday next month, aren't you?" And I couldn't understand it. Until I came up on that day, I wasn't preaching, I came up to the Sunday school and I walked in, and there were a whole lot of little chairs like this. Seen these sort of chairs? You know, Sunday school chairs? And the chairs were sitting in a circle. But they weren't just sitting in a circle like this. They were sitting inside a whale. They had made a whale out of chicken wire and paper mache and various metallic things which gave it shape. Now, Mrs. C wasn't a very tall lady, but what she lacked in height, she made up for in width. And I myself, lest it be thought that I was, you know, having a go at her, I myself at that time was 25 kilograms heavier than I am now. So we were both people of substance.
Size.
but Mrs. C and I and seven children climbed into the whale. And we all sat there in this amazing structure on our little seats, and I told the story of Jonah and the whale. And I have never been as engrossed in or connected with a Bible story as that story on that day. It all became frighteningly real in the gloomy but somehow comforting confines of that whale, as six children and two overweight adults sat there celebrating the miracle of God's love for us. Now, I think we miss a lot by not having kids. And when I was thinking about recreation, I thought there's nothing more recreating in a community than kids. And I thought we've got to have a kids talk today. We can't talk about recreation and not have some acknowledgement of the wonderful, generative and life-giving power of children. So I went hunting today and I found that we've only got one of our little children's chairs left. The others are all in storage out in the shed, I'm told. And what I want to do is bring a couple of them in and leave them lying around the front here, Eddie, to add to the clutter. The reason for that is that I was once in a Jewish synagogue after Operation Cast Lead, which was one of the periodic Israeli invasions of the Gaza Strip. And normally the death toll is it's always quite asymmetric. There are far more Palestinians than Israelis die. But on this particular occasion, three soldiers in a tank were actually captured by the Palestinians and spirited away. They weren't harmed, but they were just spirited away. And in an Australian synagogue, there were three chairs left out the front in memory of those three soldiers who were waiting to come home. I thought to myself, why don't we have a couple of chairs waiting for the children who are going to join our community? I met a young man in the street just through those doors on Tuesday when the choir was on and everybody was happily singing. And I invited this young man and his mum to come along to the church. And they said they might sometime. And that'd be great. When I say he was young, he was about 4 or 5 months old. But the little chair is for him and for others like him, because I think we want to be, you know, an old people's church for four-year-olds so that we can have a little bit more of that life and that vibrancy and that creativity and also that randomness and uncontrollability that you get when you have kids in church. One of my relatives was a very, very small cousin, a bit younger than I was, and his parents didn't go to church very often, but they went enough for him to understand what it was all about. And you would appreciate this, Pat, because a hymn was announced and it was a new tune. So the organist played it all the way through. And this little child, sitting on a longer pew than those in the middle here with just his parents, suddenly broke three of his mother's arms and ran along the pew. He was only very small, about five. Ran along the pew, gripped the pew at the end and looked around. He knew what was meant to happen, so he said in a loud voice, "Stand up, you dills, and sing." So sometimes children bring that sense of freshness to us. And I want to just put a couple of chairs. We won't make a show of them, but we'll have them sitting over there just to remind us how important kids are and how we can be disrupted, and please God, may we be disrupted by such wonderful, gifted young people.
Thank you, Jim. And that spirit, stand up, you dills, and we'll sing our next song, "Come Refresh Us with Love," before Jim returns to share with us some more.
With love. us with love. Sustaining God, Spirit arising, heal your wounded healers as well, as with new strength in our body made whole, how you move, who can tell? Come, refresh us with love. You draw us on, we are encouraged. Rain your gentle showers of grace, always surprising and making things new. Holy time, holy space, come refresh us with
love. Christ is risen. So the church says at Easter. And the faithful around the world respond, he is risen indeed. But what does it really mean? Is resurrection just an affirmation of a mystery, or can it actually touch us now? How does resurrection become real for us? You'll remember this quote from the last two or three weeks from Harry Williams, who says, resurrection as our final and ultimate future can only be known, or can be known only by those who perceive resurrection with us now, encompassing all we are and do. For only then will it be recognized as a country we have already entered and in whose light and warmth we have already lived. So how does resurrection touch the world of recreation, recreation? In John Brack's Australian painting, The Bar, a sallow middle-aged barmaid in a brown cardigan and an ironic grin stands at her post at the counter. Behind her at the bar stand a throng of expressionless, brown-faced office workers in dark suits and hats. The painting captures something peculiarly Australian, but there is a deeper level in which the painting captures something of the ecology, the grim interconnection of work and recreation. Recreation is close to Australia's heart. Years ago, I was an associate minister in a church which hosted a large group of visiting Americans who came complete with their bell-ringing choir. It was a wonderful time. One of the things we had was a slide night, a social gathering in which we could present aspects of our different societies. Every American set of slides was about, that's another version. That inspired, this is Edouard Manet from the 1880s, that inspired John Brack. And you can see a little bit of an insight into the understanding of recreation in two different cultures at two different times, separated by about 70 years. Back to the slide night. What we found is that every one of the American presentations featured the productivity and the working life of their little rural community. There were photographs about the industries and productive capacity of their Texas town, about education and farming and investment. There were even some presentations that had graphs. This is where we live and how we live. Then it went over to the Aussies, and every Australian slide set was actually about holidays, leisure activities, and sport. We Australians were far more into recreation than our American sisters and brothers. Recreation covers a bewildering array of human activities, from stamp collecting to skydiving, drag racing to folk festivals, even following football or lawn bowls. What on earth have all of these activities got to do with resurrection? What does recreation have to do with resurrection? Recreation comes from a Latin word, recreo, meaning to restore, refresh, invigorate, or revive. This, of course, implies some prior process of depletion or exhaustion or destruction. There is an ecology implicit in the idea of recreation, a set of realities which are intrinsically interrelated. There are ideas of work and rest, depletion and restoration, action and leisure. This structure of recreation means it is intimately connected with other activities, with other values, activities which deplete us, which sap energy or lead to lifelessness. To understand recreation, it must be seen in the context of its relationship to other activities, to work, to the responsibilities of citizenship, some of which we've referred to earlier in our reflection upon sacrifice and Anzac Day, but also with the maintenance of domestic life. Recreation is an intimate and powerful part of modern life. Capitalist economies have turned it into a huge industry. Like the Roman Colosseum of old, there are today many temples to entertainment and recreation, gyms and theatres, venues, and the greatest modern temples of all, sports stadiums. Whether your taste is football matches or art galleries, racing cars or sipping lattes, at some point in life, the reality of recreation touches all of us. We cycle between work and toil on the one hand, and relaxation and recreation on the other. Sometimes the transition's very clear. At other times, it's hidden or difficult to discern. When I was a child, the difference between work and leisure was glaringly obvious in the steelworks near my home. Around 4 p.m, the steam whistles sounded right across the city, and thousands of men covered with grime streamed out into the pubs from the factories. Today, recreation itself can become work, and it's certainly been incorporated into our capitalist economy. Sometimes it's hard to tell where work ends and recreation begins. As the ironic instructor in the fitness boot camp says to his sweating, straining, panting charges, "Are we having fun yet?" In Mark chapter 2, Jesus enters into a range of social activities that are intimately involved with the ecology of recreation of his day. He goes to a dinner party. He argues about feasting and fasting, and he enters into disputes about the Sabbath, about the boundaries between work and rest. These stories seem to have been collected around the theme of eating and holiness. But eating relates first to social life, then religious expectation and fasting, and finally to the framing of work, the picking and the eating of grain. In all of these fields, the area of social etiquette, of religious expectations, and what constitutes work, Jesus and his followers broke the rules. He confronted the social mores of his day by eating with tax collectors and sinners. His followers didn't fast. They did the opposite. They had a good time. They followed the master in daring to glean food on the Sabbath, and compromising that rigid separation between work from Sabbath rest. Jesus reshaped the boundaries around work and rest, around social holiness and religious observance. In the community of Jesus, the ecology of recreation is fundamentally altered. And this is summarized powerfully in the maxim that the Sabbath was made for humankind, not humankind for the Sabbath. I think if the kingdom of God was present anywhere in Jesus' ministry, it was in the freedom with which he shared with his friends. The meals they enjoyed as much in the urban dining rooms of the publicans as in the miraculous meals in the desert. There was a new ecology at work, a new framing of social and economic life, which overthrew the rigid framing of workday and Sabbath rest, the economic realities of rich and poor, and the clear distinction of holy and sinful. In the crucifixion, the old ecology of life was powerfully reasserted. If Jesus reframed social and religious and even economic life, the powers that supported the existing order, who wanted the fasts kept and all the distinctions of holiness and the rhythms and rituals of social life maintained, they moved against him and crucified him. The old order of things wasn't giving up easily. That this was the outcome of the crucifixion is revealed clearly in John chapter 21, the 14 verses of this reading. The story of how Jesus comes to the disciples when they were fishing. You see, fishing was not a recreational activity for the disciples. When we say, oh, I'm going fishing, we're talking about recreation, having a day off. But it was their livelihood. They were called from the nets and the boats. When Peter says in this story, I am going fishing, the Greek tense is actually one that indicates that he's going to do this from here on in. He's changing his lifestyle. He is going back to the boats. It's not just a decision to take a day out, relaxing at the end of the fishing line. It's a decision to return to his old life, to his former occupation. It is a re-engagement with the economy. Peter is acknowledging that the new order of Jesus, in which old divisions of work and leisure, the socially enacted codes that determined who could eat with whom, had all ended in the crucifixion. And the other disciples say, we're coming with you. It was all over. But in the morning, Jesus came to them on the beach and said, put your nets down on the other side for a catch. Peter said, we haven't caught anything. Jesus says, put your nets down on the other side. The old economy of human effort, of daily work, in which Peter had reinvested himself, was shown to be deficient. The risen Jesus reinvigorates the disciples' engagement with grace and with the mystery of the kingdom. In the book of Acts, the impact of resurrection is to smash the Christian community's dependence on the old economy totally. The former structures of owning and working and retaining are completely gone. In Acts chapter 2 and 4, we see a community sharing with all, eating and being together in worship, in a new reality grounded in the risen Christ. It wasn't just an economic reality. There was goodwill towards all, a sense of being together in heart and soul, of sharing together with glad and generous hearts. As much as a new economy, there was a new life-giving social reality. In this new economy, this new social reality, restoration, renewal, and reinvigoration is no longer a cycle of work and accumulate, and then chill out and recover. Resurrection has so reframed the world that those distinctions have been swept away. All of life is now lived under the sign of the empty tomb. All the powers of the old order, including the power to define work and leisure, to stigmatise some groups of people and some types of social interactions as undesirable, all of this fades away within the light of resurrection and the promise of the kingdom coming to power. Jesus was tried and crucified because of his actions like this, breaking the rules of polite behaviour, breaking the rules about foods and the proper relationships of work and non-work. In his resurrection, the stranglehold of economy on our lives is broken. Faith liberates us from the paralysing working to earn a holiday that characterises so much of our experience of life. Personally, I saw this pattern of working to earn a holiday most clearly in another bar, not in John Brack's 1950s Melbourne, but in an Australian bar in Manila in the 1980s. It was a bar that had a kitsch Australian decor of koalas, kangaroos and boomerangs. My Filipino hosts told me that many Australians would go to the bar near the end of their holidays when they'd tired of the nightlife and the girls for hire. I went along just to see what it was like. The clientele was solely lonely men, each wrapped around an Aussie beer. After the frantic partying of their holiday time, they were facing the flight home and another year on the tools or in the factory or in the office. And I tell you, they did not look restored, refreshed, revived or invigorated. They looked exhausted and despairing, as if on this day, delicately balanced as they were between the tawdry recreations of their vacation and the coming responsibilities of their vocation, they suddenly saw the true meaning of their existence, revealed in shades of futility and horror. That's one experience of so-called recreation. But for those of us who follow Christ, recreation now has a kingdom quality to it. The ecology of work and leisure is reframed forever in the risen Jesus. Jesus has called us to follow him, and that vocation, that calling, frames both our work and our leisure. Our work becomes something graced by the vision of Jesus, something engaged with a higher purpose, something wrapped in love, empowered by joy, and illuminated and guided by the idea of the kingdom of God. Some of you might look at me and say, that's easy for you to say, you're a minister, you're paid to do this sort of stuff. But I must admit, when I was a truck driver and then working as a consultant, I found the same experience of work through faith deeply transformed. And as work is changed, leisure also becomes truly subversive. It frees us from our usual work in the economy. It engages our creative and emotional dimensions in ways that can be deeply transforming. By stepping outside that structure of work and recreation, by refusing to allow the cycle of depletion and restoration to govern our lives, we can find in resurrection an energy that renews and reinvigorates both. I opened this sermon with a description of a painting, and I wanted to close with a description of another. It's also a scene in a bar. This is a painting by Filipino artist Emmanuel Garibay, who has painted a group of three men and a woman sharing a joke as they sit around a table drinking beer. The woman wears a red dress. All are laughing and animated, relaxed and free. It's only when you look closely at the picture that you see the nail prints in the hands of the woman. Filipino bars are full of women and men, but in this painting, the alienation that attends so many of those little groups is completely overcome. It's a picture of life that is full and deep. Yes, the marks of past suffering have left their imprint, but the old ecology and economy of women and men, of bar girl and the customers who hire her, of work and debased leisure, has been left behind in a feast of glad, warm, human community. When you see such a party, such communion, such joy, all you can say is, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
Please join me as we continue our worship, as we join in prayer for our community and our world, with again a particular nod to the sacrifice of those in our armed services today. There are responses which I invite you to join with me throughout these prayers. Jesus, Prince of Peace, hear our prayer. For all who have served the cause of peace and our armed forces, we pray. For all who have lost loved ones due to war, we pray. For all who continue to suffer due to war, we pray. For all who long for your peace, for all who dedicate their lives to your peace, we pray. For all who bring your comfort to veterans and their families, for all of us called to be messengers of your peace, we pray. Jesus, hope of humanity, hear our prayer. For all who live in despair, for all who seek healing of body, spirit, and soul, for all who live with great losses due to war, for those who trust in your promises, who cling to your words, for all who minister to veterans and survivors with your gospel, for all of us called to be messengers of your hope, we pray. Jesus, restorer of life, hear our prayer. For all whose faith has been wounded, for all whose sense of purpose has suffered due to war and violence, for those whose sense of self has been broken, for those whose journey remains incomplete without you, for all who seek completeness in you, and for all of us called to be messengers of your gospel of life, we pray. Jesus, healer of all, hear our prayer. For all whose bodies bear the marks of violence, for those whose spirits bear the scars of war, for those whose wounds are bound up in the prison of addictions, and for those who have not yet experienced your healing love, we pray. For all who rely on your healing presence in their lives, for all of us called to be messengers of your healing love, we pray. All praise to you, Jesus, Lord and Redeemer, for your gospel of comfort and peace, for your victory over death and promise of everlasting life, for your presence with us always to the end of the age, for your gift of the Spirit who makes us whole, for your gift of peace poured into our hearts, for your messengers who bring us your good news of love and peace, for your call to help spread the good news with our lives. Amen. Now please stand with me one more time as we sing our final song in the spirit of restoration and recreation, Evergreen God. Please remain standing for our closing benediction. In the lush pastures of life that hold meeting places with love, may your feet know the way to find them. By the still waters of the running stream, may your hands shape a cup and drink deep from it. In the valley of death's shadow that ever threatens, may your sense of life find the way through. At the banqueting table set before your enemies, may your cup be full and overrunning. Like the anointing oil that runs down your head, may the blessing that is you spill into the world with eternal promise. In the way a shepherd's staff warns off lameness from fear, may trust be your protective companion on the way. Through each day's living as it unfolds, may goodness and mercy make their way into every moment. At the doorway to the house of the Lord of life, may you recognize your home and your hearth. And in the song that makes a dwelling place in your heart, may its music rise in your soul. Amen.
Get another word.